Yes, you do.
China side partner, Professor Ren, is right here, and we are very happy to bring you the latest in our speaker series, our first for the spring semester, Professor Glenn Schwaiger. Come on out here.
Oh, okay.
I think you're talking to many old friends, but for those of you who don't know, Glenn is an artist and an associate professor at the Dona Ana Community College in pottery. He's just come back from 3 months in China throwing pots at imperial kilns. And we are so excited to have him. Oh, I should also mention, not unimportant, he's also now a student of the Chinese language and one of our Without further ado, I'm going to let you get into 1,000 slides?
No.
Anyway, join me in welcoming Glenn Schwaiger to talk to us about his time in China.
Well, welcome everybody. Many of you already know my name is Glenn Schwaiger, and for the benefit of my Mandarin speaking guests tonight, I'll say hello to them. 你们好，我的中文名字是格伦。 Okay. Okay. So it's great to see so many people here. I was a little nervous going through my slides. I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to organize them properly and what I would talk about. But I think with so many welcoming folks, I'm going to be just fine. Well, I was 3 months in Jingdezhen, China. I went over with a group from West Virginia University. They have a study abroad program. And I want to mention them and just a few others, and then we'll get into the presentation. I'd like to thank the Confucius Institute for sponsoring my presentation tonight. I'd also like to acknowledge the Dona Ana Community College for allowing me to take a sabbatical leave, a long overdue sabbatical. I think it had been 25 years since I had a break, and after 3 months of being cut loose in a country I didn't know too much about previously, I was really jazzed. I almost thought I could stay there a little bit longer. And I also like to thank the people of China who I met when I was there, and their hospitality was so genuine that it made me want to return. I was amazed at how warm and gracious the Chinese people were. And finally, as many of you know, if not for my wife Leanne's organization and encouragement for me to travel, set up the presentation for this evening. Without her help, I probably would be too nervous to do it. So thank you to Leanne. So I chose a spectacular image here. I remember one day near the end of the time when I was in Jingdezhen, I hired a cab because I had seen some public artworks throughout town, and the cabbie knew of some, and he drove me around, and then he dropped me off, pulled up aside the lake, a little park here, and he pointed out at the lake, and here is this enormous dragon. It's probably about 25 feet tall and 60 feet long. It's just huge, and it's covered with ceramic tiles in cobalt blue. And the dragon is an auspicious and powerful symbol. It has a long history in China. It's often associated with the emperor, but you also can see it on more commonplace items as well. And this particular dragon is sporting 5 claws, which would tell you that he's the top of the heap. Five clawed dragons are often depicted in an imperial environment, so he's truly spectacular. And one of the things that also occurred to me, of all the amazing things I saw in China, I hadn't seen this dragon for like 2.5 months till the cabbie took me there, and then finally I saw it, and it reminded me of how many grand and spectacular things there are in China, from the natural landscape to the things that people make. And in some ways, I almost expected it to be there. And it was kind of a wonderful visit because I got off and I walked around and nobody was there at the park, and I made a big circle around the entire lake and just looked at the dragon. I can still remember today how marvelous that was. So a good opening to the presentation. And then we're here to talk about ceramics, porcelain in particular, because porcelain is a very special material. In the late Tang Dynasty, which is around 900 AD, ceramic artists started to use a very pure kind of clay. And in China, they have a material called that we call China stone. And it's a type of rock that, if it's crushed up into a powder and then heated, ends up being essentially porcelain. And then in addition to that China stone, they also discovered a material called kaolin. And in fact, the word kaolin actually is derived from a town, a small town in China called Gaolin, which means high ridge. And it's thought that the word Gaolin to the English ear sounded like kaolin. And the other day I thought to myself, is that true? And I looked up in the dictionary, and sure enough, the term kaolin is based on the small town of Gaolin. So between the China stone and the kaolin clay mixed together, it created this material that we call porcelain. And the Chinese figured it out. They had been firing kilns for a couple thousand years already. But around the Song Dynasty, around 900 AD or so, they figured out how to mix this China stone and kaolin together. And also, they had the kilns that were available to make this material that, as has been described, it sounds like a ringing of a bell. And I brought in a small, very simple pot from Jingdezhen, and we'll give it a little ring and see if it's true to its nature. And as a material, it's just spectacular. And what happened is these pots started working their way out through the Silk Road, got to the Middle East, and eventually got into Europe. And people were amazed by it, and they didn't know what it was. There was speculation that it was made out of eggshells buried for 300 years and all other kinds of guesses as to what it is. And it actually wasn't for 700 years after the Song Dynasty that finally in Europe a German chemist was able to figure out what porcelain was. So China had the wraps on this material for 700 years, and folks admired it, but they just couldn't tell what it was. So here's a wonderful dragon. This is the three-toe version, so he's a little bit more of a pedestrian dragon. And I come from a background as a potter. I'm a teacher as well. But I've always had in my heart a kind of closeness to pottery. And one of the things that I like about it is that it commonly involves working together with people. And it has to be that way, because one person can't mix their clay and make their pots and build the kiln and fire it and do all of those things. So inevitably, people start to work together. And I had some romantic notion about what it was like to work in communities of potters, or say in Japan or in China or Korea, what I had read about. And I saw illustrations like this one where the potters are sitting in this idyllic environment working together to create artworks. Well, some of that is true. Some of what you see here is true, is that people in China today each have a specialty and they work on that specialty and everybody contributes to the final product. The idealized vision of being out in this wonderful landscape, I don't think it was any better back then than it is now. Most of the workshops that I visited were pretty rough places, just as you would expect here. The workshops are dirty. So what we're going to see as we go through the slides is that there's a specialty in the skills. Maybe somebody just makes clay. Maybe somebody else is just the potter. Somebody else just carries things from one place to another. But it's this system of working together to run a series of artworks through and eventually get to the kiln and make a lot of pots. And that's the secret to working as a team, is that you can make a tremendous amount of high quality pots. So you can serve the common folks, that's important. You can serve trade, and that's certainly true for the pots that came out of Jingdezhen. And you can also serve the imperial tastes. And all those were true. Okay. And then A little quote from a Japanese artist and writer. I know we're talking about Chinese art here, but Soetsu Yanagi in the 20th century wrote about ceramics that were made within the context of the people. And he looked back to the Song Dynasty and he said, what is it about pots from the Song Dynasty in China that are so intriguing and so beautiful to us today? And his conclusion was that when art is made by a group of people, it's inherently beautiful. But when we try to make art by ourselves, it's very difficult, and it's a challenge. If we rely, as we do very much in the West, on intellect, technique, and individuality, very little fine work comes out of that. In the West, I think we have this concept that the artist works on their own, and they create something, smoking clove cigarettes, you know, and then all of a sudden they produce it. But that's not really practical to serve the people. So we need to think about making art within the context of your neighbors, and that's really what's unique about Jingdezhen in China and the Orient in general. Okay, so we have a map here. You can see Jingdezhen. I'll just come over and point it out. Okay. It's about the same latitude as Las Cruces, and it's considered a semi-tropical environment. It was quite beautiful when I was there, about the same temperature as we have here, but a little bit rainier. And then the other slide on the right shows the location of Jingdezhen and its proximity to rivers. And I'll just point it out in case you don't see it right here. And it sits on the Changjiang River, which flows into Poyang Lake. And then Poyang Lake flows into the Yangtze River and then out to contemporary Shanghai. Or they would also drag pots up the Kang River and then do a portage and then float down into Canton or Guangzhou, as it's called today. So this river passage was instrumental in providing access for ceramics that came from Jingdezhen to be delivered throughout the world. And here's an illustration. Again, kind of idealized, but you get the idea. The pots are loaded up onto small vessels and then transported onto larger ones and then eventually out to the China Sea and picked up by either Arabian boats or boats from the Dutch or anyone who's trading at the coast. So there are a few things that made Jingdezhen become a porcelain capital or center. One is that it has a vast supply of high quality clay and glaze materials. It has that material called China stone. It has kaolin, those are the two main ones, and then it has the associated materials for making glazes. It had those then, and it still has it have them today. I read an account that there's another 300 years at least of materials that are needed for the porcelain. The river passage to the sea we talked about. And then the geography was protected Jingdezhen relatively from major conflict. When the Mongols came in from the north, they didn't destroy Jingdezhen. It was kind of secure. And then also something that helped protect Jingdezhen a little bit was that the imperial kilns were located there, and you wouldn't want to tear up your kilns. And when there was social strife, sometimes the kilns would just be taken over by the next group. So the geography helped protect the Jingdezhen. And the imperial sites, I mentioned that. And then finally, the craftspeople in the area were able to maintain a high level of work over the years. They innovated as time went on and continued to make new and different and exciting work. So the people are certainly part of the success. So here's a view of some bronze sculptures. There were 72 sculptures in all. It's sometimes described that there are 72 distinctive steps in order to make a porcelain vessel. So on this bridge across the Changjiang River, there are different vignettes here. This is a couple gentlemen, one's crushing up some China stone with a hammer and the other one is pulverizing it with a foot-powered mallet. So this river, Changjiang, was also the source of the name of Jingdezhen before the Song Dynasty, and they called it Changnan, which means basically south of the Chang River. and pots were coming out of Changnan, stamped on the bottom, Changnan. And when they finally made it to Eastern Ear or to Western Ears, and people would hear the word Changnan, it would sound like China. Other people think maybe it's based on the Qin dynasty, but think about it, it makes sense. This material of porcelain, which is so tied to China, even the Chinese don't call themselves Chinese. It's China, it's the material. And what better place to get the source of that than from Jingdezhen, from this town called Changnan. Okay, so in addition to the Changjiang River, there's three other rivers that flow in, and those rivers connect to a lot of the material sources for the kaolin and glaze material. So this was a major thoroughfare and was important for materials as well as passage of pots. Okay, and then how did it become Jingdezhen? In the Song Dynasty, one of the emperor's names was Jingde. And Jen means town. So then became Jingde Town, Jingdezhen. Okay, so that's the history of the name for Jingdezhen. I wanted to read a couple passages here from a book. One's out of the Traditional Crafts of Porcelain Making by author Bai Ming. In the Jingde period of the Song Dynasty, the name of Changnan Town was changed to Jingdezhen. From then on, it became more and more famous for her exquisite porcelains, described as being as white as jade, as thin as paper, white bright as glass, and as sweet sounding as the ancient chime stone. Now it is universally acknowledged as the capital of porcelain. Okay, and then I have four slides I'm going to show you, and it has workers in different stages. This is from a book titled The Porcelain Thief by author Huan Xu. Far from the quaint, pristine old China of the Western imagination, each area of this bustling artistic and industrial hulk was dedicated to one part of the porcelain making process, from sourcing clay to packaging finished goods, and everything was done by hand. Entire neighborhoods of craftsmen spent their entire lives mixing one glaze, throwing one shape, or applying a single brush stroke. Even the porters, moving the pieces through the city on bamboo yokes or hand carts, specialized in the items they transported. This narrow division of highly skilled labor, along with the area's unique resources, allowed Jingdezhen to monopolize the market for a better part of a millennium. So these are photographs from modern Jingdezhen. It's an interesting contrast. It has older buildings, traditional buildings. It has a lot of buried kiln sites and history that still remains to be uncovered. But it's also a modern city with cast concrete high-rise buildings. There are a lot of cranes. A lot of construction is happening in the city today. And it's a working class city. There are streets that are called the Hardware Street or Decal Street or the Glaze Street. And it's not the prettiest town in a lot of respects because it's a working town. In fact, one of the folks that I met when I was traveling had a guidebook, and there was a warning in the guidebook, by all means you should stay away from Jingdezhen. And it described how it's just full of streets of people working and it's dirty and noisy. But for a ceramic artist, it was like a playland for me. So here's part of the Hardware Street. And the people were so curious and warm and generous everywhere I went. Here's just a group sitting around outside a shop and playing cards. And I saw this all throughout China. One of the things that really struck me is, even in this working city where most people were busy, they were never so busy that they wouldn't stop what they were doing to say hello or to try to communicate or to share a little bit of their day. That happened over and over again. And it made me believe that it's human interaction that's most important, not necessarily how much you get done. And this was the a gentleman who I bought sweet potatoes from on a regular basis. I love sweet potatoes, and he usually sat up outside the door where we were staying. And come Thanksgiving, we tried to return the generosity by making a Thanksgiving meal for our Chinese host. And I invited him to bring his sweet potato wagon, and I paid him to have sweet potatoes. And I remember after that, for a couple days, whenever I'd stop by his wagon, he would give me sweet potatoes, but he wouldn't take any money from me. Yeah, so I thought it's funny sometimes what you do, you sort of start looking like what you do, and his skin is a bit like a roasted sweet potato. But he had the great, he was the warmest person. It seemed like everybody was generous to the degree of what they had. It was amazing. And there were pots everywhere in Jingdezhen. No matter where you go, there's pots, there's molds, there's pots, there's some being fired, there's finished pots, and they're moving all around. So this is just one of literally hundreds of vistas of pottery. And here's pots in a shop. These, though these look spectacular, and they are, they're porcelain, this actually came from an area of town they called Fake Street. So you can assume that everything in here is a fake, if you can think of it in those terms. Whereas somebody else said, well, if it's porcelain, it's porcelain. It doesn't matter whether it's fake or not. But I think what they're saying is that these are based on historic designs. They wouldn't necessarily be an ancient Qing or Ming dynasty vase, but they had been reproduced to mimic that. But the whole idea of mimicry is something that has a long-standing tradition in China as well, so it's not necessarily a bad thing. They're beautiful by any account. And there's the lampposts and street signs are sheathed in porcelain. The trash vessels sometimes is amazing. I wasn't the only person who noticed that there was an overload of porcelain. Every place you turned, there was a porcelain something or other, and you almost became numb to it. But I enjoyed it. So this is the front gate of the sculpture factory. In 1956, the Chinese government established 10 government factories in Jingdezhen, and each one of them specialized in a certain aspect of the production. And the sculpture factory did just that. They had people who did made molds and made three-dimensional objects. All of the factories that began then had closed down, had gone out of business within 20 or 30 years. And by 1990, they were pretty much in ruins. So by 2000, a woman named Carolyn Cheng decided she was going to try to come in and breathe new life into the sculpture factory. So that's what she did. And she thought that if she could get international artists to come in and work there, and they were local craftspeople who could work with them, that it would revitalize this area. And sure enough, that's what happened. So this is the front gate to the old sculpture factory, and it's now kind of the home for a place called the Pottery Workshop, which is a business that's run for education and international cooperation between artists. I think it's a wonderful model. And these are the old smokestacks. Very few of these, if any, are functioning now. It's said back in the Song Dynasty that there were as many as 300 kilns operating at one time. And of course, that ebbs and flows over the years. There's probably 40 or 50 of smokestacks like this in Jingdezhen today. But the pots aren't being fired with wood or coal like they used to be. They're using primarily propane these days, which is a pretty major shift in the history of ceramic production. It's actually made for more efficient firings, more productive firings, and I think it's been beneficial. But it's lost some of that old-time charm of a smoky stack belching out coal dust. Here's one of the buildings that's still being used within the sculpture workshop today. It's certainly could use a little remodeling, but you don't need the fanciest facilities to work. This wasn't part of the pottery workshop. There was another group in here using this. And then the pottery workshop set up a cafe and galleries and provided housing. Up above the cafe here, there's housing for international artists, and they come and sit and mingle together, and it was quite a nice environment to meet new artists from around the world. They have a gallery space. And they had a staff or an artist kitchen that where meals were prepared. So we almost always had at least two meals a day where we would sit around the table and visit. And then as new artists came in, they would become part of the group and the staff members would eat with us. And this is a very common way to enjoy meals in China. If you have four or five, six people, everybody sits around and it's a very social thing. I enjoyed that about meals. They have an education center, and every Friday night they would have lectures, and 200 or 300 people would come to listen to an artist give a presentation about their work. And these are residency spaces at the pottery workshop. And then I want to show you now some of the slides of the craftspeople who are set up within this sculpture studio. And many of them have been here for 10 or 20 years or more. So this is a pile of clay. This is what they call the big ware clay because they would make enormous vases out of this. I kid you not, if I have enough time, I'll show you vases that are 12 feet tall. So this is how it starts out. This is the clay in its raw state. And this is a kind of a high-tech filter press? I think it's called a filter press, where clay is put in soft and then it's compressed and the water squeezed out of it. And this guy has a big wheel of clay. It's soft. And then they'll take that, he just flops it over and then takes it off for use. This man's name is, he gave, his English name is Satisfaction. And he was the friendliest guy. And it's common in China, if you have your picture taken, to give the peace sign, so I learned how to do that too. It was one of the ways, actually, because I didn't have the best language skills, but everybody had a phone and they could take pictures. So they always wanted to take a picture of a foreigner. So they take a picture and then give the peace sign, and then there's this thing, it's like Facebook, but it's called WeChat in China, and everyone has WeChat. So you could WeChat back and forth, and then you could have a little bit of communication without actually having good language skills. And that worked out really well. So here's Satisfaction. And he sold clay, and he sold other glaze and clay materials. And he's somebody who I would visit on a pretty regular basis. When I left, I brought back some of the materials I hadn't used, and he gave me a big hug. And then he pulled out a ram. Last year was the year of the ram, and he had made a ram sculpture, and he put it in a little box as a gift, and I brought it back with me. But that's the type of generosity of the people that I saw over and over again. This is the man who helped make molds for me, plaster molds. I met him one day. There were plenty of people to choose from, and I just sat and visited with him a little bit. And then he became the person who made plaster molds when I needed them. He made me, actually, he's working here on a mold. I had the idea of making a bamboo cup. I don't suppose I'm the first person who's thought of that. But I brought one of them in. I just wanted to show you the translucency of the porcelain.
Wow.
It's amazing. This stuff is amazing. It's like glass, and it's like steel, and it's like all kinds of materials. I mean, no wonder the world was so entranced by this. Yeah. It's like jade, too. Yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, they're truly amazing. Okay. And one of the things that I remember of... I would always try to learn a new word or some phrase or something that from the Chinese people, and I learned the word pongyo, which is friend, from this guy. Pongyo. We looked it up in the dictionary. Yeah. I would carry a dictionary with me everywhere, and also my iPhone. Eventually, I learned how to use some translation software, and just a couple words is enough to get you in. This is the guy who ran a jigger mold shop. He has a wheel spinning there, and he throws a lump of clay on it, and it whirls around and just makes a blank, a plate blank. And he made a bunch of them.
Wow.
And it was like this, almost every shop I went to in Jingdezhen, when they were making blanks for something, they made them by the thousands. It was amazing. This is a gentleman who specialized in brush making. We went to visit his shop shop one day, and he had three workers up on a second level, and they were kind of, you know, prepping the brushes, and then he would get them down at his desk. And I remember he would pull out the bristles a little bit and look at them and trim them if they needed it, and then he'd dip it in that cup of tea and then run it across that little bamboo shape that he had there to make sure the resiliency was correct. And he spent the right amount of time. I mean, he wasn't in a hurry at all, and I was amazed. So here he is. That was his specialty. He just makes brushes. And then there were places to buy glazes. Here in the States, everybody mixes their own glaze, or, well, some people buy them. But in China, you really couldn't even make your own glazes. There were so many glaze shops, you would just go down, you would find a pot that had the glaze you wanted, and then you fill out a form, that's which one you want, and you take it right next door, and they get it out of the buckets, and you take it home with you. And almost everybody was buying glazes like this. This is the spray master. All he did was spray pots. You'd give him a glaze, and you'd show him his pots, and he'd spray them for you. And I remember the first time I asked for his help, I was a little nervous because I know the pots were fragile. In China, they often don't pre-fire the pots first. They're just in the greenware state. For those of you who are potters, you know what I'm talking about. And the last thing you want to do is put something wet on top of a dry pot. Well, the nature of this porcelain allows it to take on moisture without dissolving, because you're thinking, well, how do you put something dry and something wet, and why don't they fall apart? Well, the clays that they have can just take it. But I remember I was real nervous. I gave him a half a dozen pots, and I watched him, and because I was sure he was like going to mess it up, but he didn't. And then over time, I kind of created a relationship with him, and I felt totally comfortable. I would just drop pots off, and he would know they were mine, and he'd spray them and put them in the kiln, and that was it. So it was nice. I started to understand that. Not only did I not need to do everything, but I shouldn't do everything. What I ought to do is find out what I like to do and then find other people to help me do it. And then I started meeting more people, and that's that social context that I'm talking about. Here's the carry man. And the carry man ruled the road. They had these precious pots. These haven't been finished yet, but they're still precious. And they'd have to go really slow because it was kind of precarious. And they would go in the streets and over potholes, and they really would focus on their work. And the traffic, which is kind of crazy in China, would just swerve around them or whatever. But they always respected the carry man. And Leanne reminded me to tell the story about how you get across a busy street when you're a pedestrian. You kind of step to the curb, and you look both ways, and the traffic sees you and you see the traffic, and when it looks reasonably safe, you step out into the traffic looking out of both eyes, and you just walk steady across, and the rest of the traffic, just like you were a stone in the river, the traffic just swerves around you. And they go into the other lane, or if it's a moped, it goes up onto the sidewalk, but it's just like once you step into the traffic, the whole flow of the river changes, and then you get to the other side and you're good to go. It was amazing to see traffic. The traffic lights were like a suggestion, and the road lines. Mopeds would go against the traffic, and then they'd go up on the sidewalk, you know, and then back into traffic, and then across the grain, like jaywalk, across a busy intersection. It was amazing. And the traffic just flowed like water. Everybody was respectful. I didn't see much, if any, road rage at all, despite how dense it was. It's just amazing to behold. And here's a press mold master. In Jingdezhen, they call them Shifu, which means master. And I come to find out that anyone can be Shifu. Even the cab driver was Shifu, and the mold maker was Shifu, and the doorman where we stayed, he was Shifu as well. So it's just like to acknowledge that they're a master of something. So he's working on a two-piece mold here, and inside it, you can see the clay has been pressed in with a little bit of ribbing to give it some support. And that's porcelain, of course. And so two halves come together, and then this is the finished piece. There's actually at least four pieces to this, because two of them would be the body, and then two more would be the head. And it's not just as simple as having a mold. The mold is just like a blank, and then that goes together. That has to be put together and then cleaned up really well. Little doodads are put on it. It's really laborious. And there were a lot of Maos still being made in Jingdezhen. There must still be a market for them. And then here's a group of gentlemen. I hope this video will run for us. They're loading these large figures into the shelves of the kiln. And it's just this coordinated effort. Let's see if we can get it to run. Those are all greenware, all just as fragile as can be. They haven't been fired yet, it's just dry clay. No big deal. I don't know how many times I would go when they were loading kilns or pushing them in and watching them work. And sometimes there'd be a group of people and they weren't sure quite how it would fit. And as is typical in China, they could get into a conversation that elevates to what seems like an argument. And then finally they come to a resolution and it's quiet and they just do it. And they move on. And the same thing when if you had to negotiate with someone, you wanted to rent a truck, you'd like buy a pack of cigarettes first and you go and introduce yourself and offer them the cigarettes, and then there's this kind of heated discussion, and then there's a handshake, and next thing you know, someone's helping you with the truck. So here's the Mao kilns, as they call them. There's three kilns in the background, all these modern steel-framed fiber kilns with propane fired, which is really different from the whole history of firing ceramics in China. They had big kilns that fired for 4 or 5 days. These kilns, actually, I can remember going in, they would push the pots in at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and fire it up, and the guy would fire overnight. And when it reached temperature, they would shut it off and do what's called flash cooling and pull the kiln open and let some of the heat come out so that by 10 o'clock the next morning they could unload it. Yeah, to cone 13, for potters, you know how hot that is. I remember one day I was in, there was a big kiln firing like this and it was screaming like a jet. Nobody was around. They had a pyrometer on there, 1,327 degrees centigrade. Yeah, whoa. white heat. And the shrinkage rate on these clays from the greenware state to the fired state is 20%. 20%. And imagine putting a piece in that's these big ones, they put them in at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and pull them out the next day. Within 24 hours, they had been up to cone 13 and cooled down. Really amazing. Okay, so Mao's there, and then there are also a lot of sculptures made that serve Buddhist or Taoist purposes. So from the white, from the pure white, as we see here, these would just be fired, and they'd be white when they come out, and then they get overglaze decoration often, and they look like this. And the overglaze decorating, of course, is a skill on its own. And these are hand-painted. I'd seen pictures of them before and thought, oh yeah, they're just, well, I don't know. I didn't know exactly how they were being done, but I saw these being painted by hand by craftspeople in the shops, just little brush strokes all filled in. It was amazing. No. If they did any airbrushing, that wasn't the most time-consuming part. I didn't see any airbrushing being done on the glazes. Yeah, like all this stuff was just all filled in by hand. Just amazing. I mean, I think it might take 100 hours to glaze one of those. And then you imagine these. Then they got the carry man who's taken like 8 of these really slow through the streets. Every time I saw a carry man, I was just mesmerized by it. Whether it was greenware pots or finished pots rolling through the street, it was like a celebration. Yes. Okay, so the overglazes are enamels, and those were fired in the range of, they were really low, like, I'm going to, cone 0, 13 or 18 or something like that. It'd be about, I'm trying to think of Fahrenheit, maybe 1400 or 1500 degrees for the overglaze. Yeah, they're much lower. These really bright colors, overglaze decorations, are a much lower temperature. So they would be refired in a enamel kiln. And then here here's a public kiln. These are the types of kilns where we would tend to have our pots fired. You can see different styles of pots, and these are all the folks who are here are came to pick them up. And so they would just get their pots out and then pay the kiln man for the space that had been used, and that's how we all did it. And if one of your pots blew up, you had to go back and fess up to it. If your pot blew up and damaged somebody else, you paid for the other person's work. So there's a bit of responsibility that went along with it. You can't just go there and cause problems and not pay for them. Oh, I had a little bowl. Yeah, there's a little. Let's see. Can you see that one? Mm-hmm. That's mine. And I love to go in the morning if I had pots. Like, if I put pots in today, tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, they'd be done. And you'd have to go back because people are raking through them. And the kiln man needs to break this down, get all the pots out, because he's going to put another load of pots that have to go in the next day. So you don't dally around. You come in and you get them and, you know, get them out of there. But I like to see in the morning when they pulled it out and the coal kiln, all the pots were still so hot you could hardly touch them. And people are all crowded around trying to fish them out. And on a couple occasions, I would buy pots from the people who made them right there, because you knew it's like, well, they, you know, that's the source. Okay, so many people in Jingdezhen had really high skills, throwing pots, decorating, glazing, or whatever. And I tried throwing this clay, a couple of the different types of porcelain, and I'm a pretty good potter, but I came to understand that I don't have nearly the skills to throw this material in a manner that I was going to learn within even a couple months. I mean, it's really tremendous skill. So one day, I was out looking around for potters who could make shapes that I liked, and I came across this shop, and you can see here, this is probably one day's production. For I don't know how many people, maybe there were two potters who threw these in one day, but it's just, that's just throwing them. Then someone else is like pre-centering the clay and delivering those, and someone else is taking them away. But these are all wet, and the shop didn't have a lot of employees. So I thought to myself, there's no way I can make pots like that. So I started seeking out people whose pots I liked, and these big bulbous ones here, one of them anyhow, ended up being this pot. And I made this when I was there. It has an inlay design, which in Japan is called Mishima. So it has a slip inlay, and it has a flower design on it. And it's quite large, about 22 inches. And we were studying a little bit about Chinese history and culture during the time when this pot was being made. And I was introduced to a movement in Chinese history called the Hundred Flowers movement or campaign, and it started out as a means to invite people to make a positive or insightful criticisms about the government. But what happened is initially the comments came in slow, and then more comments were encouraged, and eventually some really strong comments came in, and there was a backlash by the government, and as many as 300,000 people were re-educated through labor as a result of their comments. Chairman Mao is attributed to this saying, "The policy of letting 100 flowers bloom and 100 schools of thought contend is designed to promote the flourishing of the arts and the progress of science." So it sounds like a pretty good idea, but it didn't quite work out that way for whatever reasons. And I wasn't so much interested in making a political statement, but I was feeling sympathetic for the artists in 1956 and 1957 who expressed their concerns and then had their liberties taken from them. So this is maybe a quiet way of having solidarity with those artists. And this is a carved porcelain designed with a celadon glaze. It's quite large. I left this with the pottery workshop because I was concerned that it might crack in transit. And I also thought that it would be a nice gesture to leave something that I made with the entity that hosted me. How are we doing on time? Get an idea how much time I got.
6:49.
Oh, boy. Okay, so. Imagine if we could walk from history up over that hill from where we are now and go back in time and see some of the ancient pots. Just imagine. Back back to the Tang Dynasty. This is a dynasty before the Song, which is where I really want to go. But during the Tang Dynasty, these popular sansai, or three-color glazes, were used a lot on sculptures. You might have seen these before. And horses and riders like this would commonly be part of tomb burials. The horse being a powerful animal would represent the power of the person who passed. And these are from the Song Dynasty. And the Song Dynasty had a rather reserved quality to it. It wasn't flamboyant like a lot of the later work, and it seemed like the people were less needy as far as bright colors and all of that. They were very reserved. And here's some carved ewer in a vase, also from the Song Dynasty. And that platter that I made that was carved was kind of inspired by this style. And then potters nowadays, including Soetsu Yanagi, who I wrote that passage from, have always marveled at the beauty of these ancient Song pots, which oftentimes weren't signed. So they're made in workshops by people who are making them by the thousands and going into kilns. And they just have an inherent beauty about them. And I would say that even by today's standards, if you were a potter and you could get pots like this out of your kiln, you'd be doing well. And many people believe that the pots that were made in the Song Dynasty represent the highest standards of excellence. Whether you agree with that or not, I'm just kind of letting you know that potters feel that way. And I think in some respects I would agree. And during the Song Dynasty, the silk trade route was active. And I just wanted to point out, here's where this little pot is. This little blue and white pot is Jingdezhen. And from there, ceramics would travel and silks would travel across to the Middle East. And it was during the Song Dynasty that potters were turned on to Persian cobalt. And cobalt was really bright blue. And so the cobalt came back, and as a result of getting their hands on cobalt, the blue and white, or Tsinghua, that we really associate with China, started happening in the Yuan Dynasty. Okay. So on the left, a Yuan Dynasty vase with that pure white porcelain and that beautiful blue cobalt. It also helped that the Mongols who took over in the Yuan Dynasty thought white was a sacred color. So that helped preserve the Jingdezhen kilns. So I have a little passage I want to read here about the pot on your left, the one from the Yuan Dynasty. By the Yuan Dynasty, the network of foreign traders in China was well established. While Chinese taste ran towards subdued monochromes, Middle Eastern and Persian markets favored boldly painted porcelains. The Persians already knew that cobalt pigment could produce vibrant blues, but they could produce only low-quality ceramic bodies. The Yuan court, seeking to increase its export revenues, hit upon the idea of using Persian cobalt to decorate Chinese porcelain. The resulting snow-white porcelain painted in rich blues created a sensation, and Jingdezhen's blue and white wares were shipped across the world. And then on the right, the dynasty following the Yuan Dynasty, the Ming Dynasty, continues. So I'll read another passage. As the Yuan gave way to the Ming in 1368, marking the restoration of native Chinese rule, that was the Han people. The Mongols were kicked out and the Hans took over. Jingdezhen maintained its preeminence. The conquering Ming Emperor Hongwu consolidated the legitimacy of his rule in part by ordering new vessels for ceremonies, rites, and sacrifices. But instead of gold, silver, or bronze, he insisted that all the sacrificial objects be made of porcelain. Subsequent Ming emperors established the official imperial kiln in Jingdezhen, where the quality and quantity of production were held to exacting standards. A production run of 1,000 identical objects might yield just a handful of acceptable ones to send on to Beijing. So this one on the right is probably an imperial vase. I've seen it reproduced before. I don't know its exact history, but I look at this little five claw on the dragon, and that's usually reserved for imperial ceramics. Well, the Dutch got in on it. Let me back up. See, these are the Chinese ones. These are Dutch. This is Delftware. And Delftware is sort of a response to the fact that Chinese porcelains were being brought back to Europe, and they liked them so much, or they didn't know how to make them, so they used a low-fire clay body with a white tin-based glaze to make it look like porcelain, and then cobalt over the top of it. And you can see here, even the designs look rather oriental. So the Dutch were bringing in a lot of pots, but they apparently couldn't bring in enough, and they're trying to make them domestically. I read one account that as much as two-thirds of the sailors who tried to make the trip from Europe to China and back, as many as two-thirds of them didn't make it. So that's a pretty high price to pay. But these are not porcelain. They're a different kind of clay, but they certainly look like the Chinese porcelains. And here's the Dutch trade routes. The Dutch were the greatest commercial nation, country, in the 1600s. And also in the Ming Dynasty, the Hanwu reign, the cobalt fell a little bit out of favor, and in place of that, you see these beautiful copper reduction reds. They're very temperamental. It's not as easy to get a copper red as it is a cobalt blue. And I've always sort of favored the copper reds. They can be very spectacular. There's kind of a haze on here. You can see that red looks like it's a fog, and that's because copper volatilizes or turns to a fume in the kiln, and it floats around a little bit. So that's why it has that red fog on it. And this demonstrates that during the Ming Dynasty, there were also Arabian artists in Jingdezhen making plates for export. So not only were they sending them plates, they had the artists there making plates to send back. And finally, in the Qing Dynasty, a style called Famille Rose, this overglazed decorating, very subtle, semi-opaque overglazing, reached its zenith. And when I was in Shanghai at the museum, I ran across this vase, and it was only later that I learned a little bit about the history of it. So I'm going to read that to you. Okay. Incidentally, a lot of the imperial ceramics were taken or spirited out of China in the 1800s and into the early 1900s. There were occupation by no fewer than eight European and United States as well countries in the Forbidden City and in China. And quite a few of the imperial treasures were taken during that time by whatever means, and some of them are being repatriated, and this is one of them. Okay, so that's the context for this. One of the most popular items for Jingdezhen's porcelain imitators to produce was a white ovoid Qing Dynasty vase decorated with pastel-colored Famille Rose peaches on a branch. This guy. Made during Yongzhen's reign, the original vase wound up in the possession of the American ambassador to Israel, who used it as a lamp base for 50 years. Oh. When the Sotheby's experts received a photograph of it with lampshade and all in the early 2000s, they rushed a team to New York, where the vase sat unprotected in the owner's home. The shape was rare. They knew of only four in the world, and all were blue and white. One with delicate pinks and vibrant greens was too rare to dream about. This vase sold in Hong Kong in 2002 for $5.3 million to Alice Cheng. Alice Cheng is the mother of Carolyn Cheng, who is the principal director at the pottery workshop. So you can see where influence kind of, you know, spreads itself around. Carolyn Cheng is a ceramic artist herself. Okay. The vase is in the Shanghai Museum. It's actually like a centerpiece of their porcelain collection there. And a lot of these that I'm showing you, they say Jingdezhen on the bottom. These have been identified as coming out of Jingdezhen kilns. Jingdezhen is not the only place that ceramics was made in China by any account, but the fact that it had imperial designation and it was producing such high quality wares makes it what people call the porcelain capital of the world. Thank you. And then finally, by the late Qing dynasty, a lot of European influence came in, and really fanciful overglazes started to enter into the pots. And here's a quite nice celadon glaze with overglaze decoration. Okay, so this is an ancient kiln in Jingdezhen from the Qing dynasty. Actually, inside is the kiln. This is just the housing for it, and you can see the stack. And if you could see inside, it has kind of an egg-shaped form. And this is the actual chamber of the kiln. And these, what look like pots here, are actually saggers. And a sagger is a vessel that protects the pot during the firing so the flames and ash don't light on it. So these old kilns and all this pure white porcelain all had to be fired in saggers. They don't do that anymore because there's not smoke and fire and all of that. They don't need saggers, and it's made the contemporary firings much more efficient. So here's a gentleman using the traditional technique for trimming. These are the old style wheels. And an illustration of how they work. Sometimes one guy turns it and the other guy does the potting. And some carving, high relief carving. Overglaze decorating. And the variety of forms, classical Chinese forms, and then finished pieces in the back. This is all at a folk art museum, so it's set up to demonstrate the history of the production. And this is kaolin clay. This is what was added to the China stone in order to help the temperature elevate and for larger forms to be made. And we went to Gaoling, which is the birthplace of kaolin. This is where kaolin was first discovered, and it's now a national park. And so we visited there. And that's Gaoling is sort of sounds like kaolin. And we also visited a dragon kiln. You can see it's underneath this awning is a kiln that stretches up the hill. There's the spine of it. And then it's stoked from the side. These little holes are for stoking wood. So you fire it and stoke and stoke and stoke, and smoke and flames are belching out of it. It might take 4 or 5 days for the entire kiln to be fired to reach temperature, and then maybe 3 or 4 more days for it to cool. And this is inside the kiln. This was moved from its original location by a gentleman who was in his 70s. He and some helpers moved it and set it up here, and it's actually a producing kiln today, a dragon kiln. And here's an illustration of how they were fired. And on the left, a steamed bun kiln, because it's shaped like a steam bun. Baozi. And a picture of the kiln being fired. And I want to point out on this one, they're firing it, of course, and then here's some pots that came out that turned out all right. But more often than not, you get a bunch that don't turn out so good. They end up in shard piles. Well, something that I didn't realize until I was in Jingdezhen is that the shard piles were enormous, and there were shards everywhere. And there people were finding, they would do road cuts, and they would find several meters thick of shards, or they would do a foundation for a house, and there'd be, as someone's account, there were more shards than dirt. Yeah. So imagine if you had one time you had 300 enormous kilns, you know, working around the clock, and a lot of pieces don't come out. You get a lot of shards out of that. So these are at the shard market, and there are just countless piles of them. There's pots that have all melted into each other. These. They got too hot and they melted, and then there's saggers mixed up in there, and then these are all fragments of pots that broke, and they're just thrown away. It's trash. Well, there's a whole market for shards nowadays. Here's some from a contemporary factory. Not quite as charming as the old ones, but you can see there's just piles and piles of refuse. I met a woman who was trained as a ceramic engineer, and she said one of the problems with ceramics nowadays is that they fire them, and the tolerance for fault is so low that they have to throw a lot of them away. And she said you can't recycle it. There's nothing you can do with a fired pot. And they just pile up like this, and there were piles like this everywhere. imagine 1,000 years of making pots, how many shards there were. So this is the shard market or the antique market, and people would bring, pot hunters would go out and get shards, and they bring wares, buyer beware. They'd say, some people would say that 90% of them aren't real, but I'm not so sure that's true. So here you see them, here are the little old saggers. These very well could be 1,000 years old because they got pots melted in them. They're no good, they just throw them away, and then pot hunter finds them and brings them out to the market. And these are all shards of pots. They cut the foot ring out of them and then make them into little coasters. And I brought some of them here. If you like this evening, you can take a look at them. Yeah, the table in the back. Okay, and some of these might be Sung Dynasty pots, but again, buyer beware. Buyer beware. But I think the saggers with the melted pots, those are, most of those were probably genuine because they were just thrown away. And this is Huang Fei. Huang Fei was a local artist, but he also seemed to have an eye for ancient pots. And I was able to go to the shard market with him on a couple occasions. And he and I were able to scout out some pots that he thought were authentic from the Qing Dynasty. And he also, he and I found a pair of pots, kind of like this, that he thought was a Sung Dynasty water container. Nothing spectacular. So I brought one of those back, and I bought one for Huang Fei for going around with me as a gesture. But he's a very kind gentleman. So I want to show you some slides from Sanbao. Sanbao means like three treasures. It's an ancient village, and it's the source of the China stone back in history. And they're still using water hammers today. So what happens is they take this stone, this China stone, which is, and break it up into nuggets. And then they go down in these pits, and then there's a water-driven spindle that spins around, and these hammers come up and bam, and just slam it down and down. And they don't have to manage them too much. You just come in every now and then and clean out the powder. And then the powder is put into these settling tanks. You can kind of see them there on the left. And it creates a slurry, which is drawn out, and it's kind of like clay, old mucky old clay. When that's firm enough, they put it into little boxes, kind of like adobes, and they make what are called baidunsa, little white bricks. And this is the standard size for measurement. So if you're going to buy clay or whatever material, you buy so many baidunsas, and there they are stacked up. And this material itself, if you fire it, is almost like porcelain. If you add a little kale into it, then you get up to the high quality stuff that we know. And here's an old water wheel working. Same thing, 1,000 years ago, same as today. This is at the Sanbao International Ceramic Artist Residency. For those of you who are potters like myself, I think you can't help but be enamored by the prospect of living and working here and making ceramics. These are Republican-style pots. These were done right around the turn of the 20th century for the common folk. They're kind of brown and earthy, not the porcelain that we've come to think of. And this is Jackson Lee. He's quite a character. He cast a long shadow. Some people found him to be quite generous, as I did, and others weren't quite so sure. But he extended nothing less than the greatest generosity to me when I was there. So residents live here in this environment, and then they use the studio. It has a little babbling brook. It's just really idyllic. And this is his three-chamber kiln. He described that this is a typical of a kiln that would be used in the country by country potters. And he was working on some pots when I was there. I remember he was pretty busy trying to prepare pots for a firing, and then he noticed that several of us were milling around, and he said, how would you like to have tea? And of course we wanted to have tea. I learned that when you get invited for tea, that's an invitation you ought to take. And here's some wonderful little porcelain cups. So he sat us down in a small alcove in his workshop area there and made tea and visited with us. And that was a pretty special thing. We went to the big vase factory. And if you think these are big, look at those. And these. They're amazing. These guys aren't complete. This goes on top during the firing. And these are all they haven't been fired. It's all greenware clay, and then they get brushed over the top with cobalt, and they get once fired. And that's that black coloring on there is cobalt, and it'll turn blue in the firing. And then there was a woman there brushing them, and before I visited, I thought to myself, well, they must do it really fast and just knock them out. But no, she had a really delicate touch, and she would just brush it on there, just like you would think. I mean, it was amazing. I mean, how long it must take just to complete those. Yeah, they're hand-painted. Okay, and then we went to a little factory where this bowl was made. It has a distinctive little rice grain holes in it. Oh, you want the flashlight, huh? Okay. Well, it's poor, you know. You can see the rice grains on there, huh?
Hold it up.
Okay. See them? Well, these are like a dime a dozen, but what I realized is that there's people in here making them, and they care about their work, and that they're using this material that is world class, and they're just beautiful objects. So here they are, you know, all stacked up, ready for the firing. Here's the machine that's used to jigger them, and I have a short video here in just a moment. I'll show you how quick that process goes. And then this woman is applying decals. They have a repeating design on the edge, and she puts a little water and applies the decals. And this is the mechanism that's used to punch those rice grains, and it was described to me that these are actually hand-cut by a craftsperson. They wear out, and when they wear out, he cuts a new one. And there's a little rubber band on here, and when you press on it, it punches out, and that's what knocks the clay out of it. This was the only factory in Jingdezhen that's still making this style ware. Okay, so let's just take a look here. The woman's filling the holes with glaze. No, I'm over here. Okay, so there they are. Okay. You know, I think it might be easy to think to yourself, oh, what a horrible thing to be making those all day long, but people need work. And the folks that I saw who were here seemed like that their hearts were satisfied. I could just tell. I mean, everything we do is kind of grueling, but they were making beautiful things, and there's a bit of redundancy in everything that we do in our lives. Yeah, time to go. Well, I'm almost done. So here they are stacked up. When I saw this, I was like, wow, you know, just thousands and thousands of pots. And then below them, they're wrapped up in rice straw to be shipped to protect them. Well, here's the guy doing it, wrapping them up. And here's one from the Song Dynasty, an archaeological find. It's the same thing. Isn't that amazing? They're doing it the same way today. No need to change it if it's working. The big tile factory. Look at those, half an inch thick. Some of these were as big as 5 by 8 feet. This one's not quite that large. Half an inch thick. And then they would fire these and they would turn out, they were incredible. They would just roll them with a steel pipe. I mean, the clay was not like the clay we know. It doesn't have those same properties. And there are some beautiful hand-painted panels. So this is what they looked like when they just came out of the kiln. They were just like canvases, and then people would just go and pick them up and paint them. This guy painting a portrait of Chairman Mao.
Looks like he's painting
that. Oh, a little bit, yeah. I ran across this guy. He was just in this little cubby hole in the side street, and there he was painting this portrait. Okay, a couple quick pictures of places I went. I think you'll want to see these. This is Huashan, one of four sacred mountains near Xi'an. This was called the most dangerous hike in the world. I didn't go out on that. It was cold and windy, and I thought if it's that dangerous, you know. And these are prayer ribbons that are hooked onto the cables out there, and it just was spectacular. And we went to villages, and I have to say that my heart was most touched by going to the villages when I was there. I would get tired of Jingdezhen and all the clatter and rattle of it, and then when I went out to the country, I thought that this is the China that is the everyday experience, something that's really worth it. The people are washing their vegetables and cleaning their clothes and gutting chickens, like right there, that's their water source. You might say to yourself, that doesn't look too sanitary, but you know, 1,000 years out, it's still working. And I went to this incredible village called Huangling, which had used to be a farming village, and then it was remodeled or restored to be a more of a tourist destination. And I have to say, it was just marvelous there, the visual delight. All these houses are kind of nestled up against the hill, and then across in the valley, a huge valley, they had these terraced farmlands. And the history of this place is they would pick the crops and then lay them out on these basking reeds on like vigas that stick out from the buildings because they didn't have other space, but it just was a visual delight to be there. And I was treated when I was here. I met up with a person who did the development, and he took a shine to me, I think, because I was a foreigner and also because he found out I was a professor. And what ended up is he invited me and the friend I was traveling with to a couple dinners. He sent us with a guide to go to some of the buildings. And at the end of our trip, he said, I've called my driver. We're going to go to town and have dinner. And when we're done, my driver's going to drive you back to Jingdezhen. And that's what happened. Yeah, 3 hours away, he sent me home. So I sent him one of the bowls I had done, those little carved bowls. I ended up thinking to myself, one of the things I can do is leave something here. So I gave quite a few as gifts to people who were generous to me. The dentist who replaced my filling got one. The guy who did the glaze firing got one. And I thought, instead of taking something from here, what I need to do is leave it, because I got the sense that China was so generous as a nation that the best I could do was try to leave a good impression. So I think that's about it. Oh, I'll just leave it here with food. In this village of Huangling, when we went the village that hadn't been restored yet, and we walked into this kitchen, and the aromas were just rich in the air. I mean, I can smell it right now, and it was an amazing experience. There's an old style kitchen in the back, and the food had just been prepared, and the cook stepped out so I could take a photograph. But that's China.
Yeah.
That's China. That is so authentic, so authentic. And I ran into a lot of opportunities where I ate in environments like this, and it just makes me want to go back. Okay, well, I know I've used more than my allotted time. I want to make sure that if you have some questions, I can address those if you'd like to stay a little bit longer.
Sure.
Anyone?
Let's all just express our...
questions?